Hey, what's up, guys? Welcome to another Adjuster TV live stream. And according to Google, my name is still Matt. Joining me tonight is Guy Grand. He's a co-founder and head honcho. And Guy, if you could just introduce yourself a little bit, tell us a little bit about the school, and we'll kind of go from there.
Yeah. Well, cool. Hi, everybody. I'm Guy Grand. I'm the managing director of Veteran Adjusting School in beautiful Sedona, Arizona. I just want you guys all to know right up front, I don't do this stuff very often, but I really, really support Matt and Adjuster TV, and so I think this could be fun.
Well, thanks, Guy. I appreciate that.
That's $5.50.
Right. So, okay. So we're going to answer your questions and like literally anything you guys can think of that you want to ask about claims, the industry, if you want to know, you know, in detail about a veterans adjusting school, anything at all, definitely drop into the chat over there. We'll be able to see them and we'll post them up on the screen and everything. Before we do all this, I really want to give a shout out to tonight's sponsors. It's actually sponsored, which is pretty sweet. And the first one is Claim Professionals Insurance Liability Company, or CPLIC. And these guys sell errors and omissions insurance to property and auto adjusters, especially field adjusters. Especially if you're 1099 or if you're working directly for a carrier, you're probably going to need some E&O. So definitely check them out at cplic.net. And our other one is we've got an IA firm, CCMS and Associates, and they're an innovative firm that handles a wide range of claim types, including daily and commercial property. And they are currently taking applications for TWIA, which is Texas Windstorm Insurance Association. So if you're interested in that, head on over to ccmsclaims.com/work-with-us. So some of you guys may have heard me talk about AdjusterTV Plus or seen it, and some of you might already have kind of jumped in there. I'm really excited to tell you that tonight is the official launch of AdjusterTV Plus as well. And what is AdjusterTV Plus for those of you who don't know? I'm gonna tell you all about it and how it can help you be a better adjuster a bit later in the video. But I really wanna get your questions first and before we jump in. Also, got a nice fat discount at the end that we'll get to. So it's gonna pay to stick with us till the very end. And I tell you, I actually just got off the phone with Reba Wheeling from Schedule It, who's on the board at NACA. And if you don't know what NACA is, it's National Association of Claims Adjusters. I mean, the National Association of Catastrophe Adjusters. The convention in January is still a green light for now, but she wanted me to pass along some information to you guys about early bird pricing for getting on for going to that conference. So Jamie from NACA, who's there, one of the marketing people, sent this over to me a couple of hours ago. So you guys are hearing about this first right here. Let's just take a look at these prices. So the convention is in January, the middle of January. During the month of July, if you are a member of NACA, it's $299. And you guys know, like $800 is what it usually costs everybody, right? For non-members, it's $479. So the price will kind of creep up as we go get closer and closer. But it kind of pays to get in early, get locked into this thing at this low price, because it's not going to last much longer. What's that?
I said I'm definitely
going. Yeah. So Guy's going to be there. I'll definitely be there. Being a member of an organization like NACA has a lot of benefits beyond just attending the, you know, a convention, which, by the way, you can do live interviews with 50 plus IA firms, like live. Like you could sit down with them, hand them your resume, sit there and chit chat with them face to face. NACA's also got mentorship programs. They have a professional member roster that is shared with thousands of contacts. They have a benefits package for independent adjusters through Adjuster Zone, and I think it includes a medical benefit. They get discounts on stuff, gear and stuff, continuing education, and they also have tons and tons of networking opportunities. So definitely check them out at nacatadj.org and get signed up for that convention at least, /convention. And definitely you should consider becoming a member.
Sure. You want a Guy Grand story about NACA?
Yeah, let's hear it.
Okay, so way, way back in the early days before I was ever an adjuster, I got my license. I looked online, I saw this thing called National Association of Catastrophe Adjusters, had no idea what adjusting was about or anything. Went to NACA, that's where I actually met the first IA firm I ever worked for. Did those interviews that you were talking about. Back in those days, there weren't 50 of them there was only five or six.
Right.
But it was scary as hell because I didn't know anything of what I was doing. But it was probably one of the most rewarding things I ever did, was going to that. Before I ever ran a claim, before I was ever on an IA firm, it was just a way for me to understand what catastrophe adjusting was all about. So shout out to Reba too, okay, she's online here.
Yeah, so she told me when I talked to her earlier, she's like, yeah, I'll be on there totally. So if she gives a thumbs up or a hello when she gets here, I don't know if she's in here or not, you guys are welcome to ask questions.
Great organization, yeah. Though. Great place to, like you said, take your resume and to be able to go and really sit down and talk to different IA firms to see, you know, oh, I really like these guys. They'll be good to work for. This yeah. company has work in my area. This company doesn't. So it's a great, as good as it is for the IA firms to find new talent, it's just as good for us as adjusters to get out there. So.
Yeah, big time, big time. It's interesting because you can kind of like match up your personality with some of these different IA firms. You know, you might sit down with somebody and like, you know, I don't really, you know, these guys, I don't think we're clicking. And then you go sit down with the next one and you're like telling each other, finishing each other's sentences and everything else. And it's really important to have a great relationship with the IA firm because they're going to be the ones that are going to call you to send you to work. If you have a problem, you can call them. If they have a problem, they can call you, and so on and so forth. And you want to be able to have a good relationship with them. So it's pretty cool to be able to... It really is. It really is. I can't think. There's nobody else that I know of is doing that, having all those IA firms sitting there, just like they're just waiting for you to sign up and say, all right, 10:15, I'm going to go sit down with Pilot. At 10:30, I'm going to go sit down with Crawford, and just all day for 3 days, like all day long. You could conceivably interview with everybody there. Maybe we'd have to do some math on
that. That would be a little hard.
I mean, you got to eat, I guess. Yeah. So, okay, yeah, so that was actually one of the first questions I wanted to tackle here. But I have a question here from Jessica in an email. And this is actually, I thought this was actually a pretty good question. And actually, I think, Guy, you also had somebody to ask you this question. It's a common question. Jessica says, I'm a freshly licensed adjuster with Florida as my DHS. She's a Kansas resident, which Kansas does not have a license, so Florida's her designated home state license. She's been managing a contracting company for about 7 years, doing full inspections, deactivate scopes, insurance negotiations, managing and scheduling all repairs, dealing with homeowners and crews in English and Spanish, which I want to touch on in a little bit as well. She says she's rarely walked anything over a 612. She feels like it's not worth the risk. She said she could always tell from a ladder how bad the damage was, especially if you move the ladder around to multiple layers, which you can definitely do, especially on like super steep roofs. She said, or I'd have a roofer check things and take photos for me to review. So her question is, can I tell a carrier or an IA firm that I won't do steep roofs? Will that kill her odds of deployment? Guy, you want to tackle that one?
Things have changed hugely in the industry since I got in and you got in, Matt. You know, when we first started adjusting, we had to climb everything. There was no option but getting on the top ridge. In fact, when I first started, they said, we won't pay you without that photograph on the ridge. That has changed a lot. I think what Jessica asked about moving the ladder around, your inspection is going to take you an extra 30 minutes. Maybe even an extra hour, because you have to move that ladder from place to place to place, four or five places on the front slope, four or five places on the back slope. The other thing too, most houses in my experience will have a patio off the back. So even if it's a steep roof or whatever, a lot of times you can get somewhere or on the front porch. you know, or something like right. that, to where you can actually inspect that roof. It is on a light hailstorm. It's going to be difficult to inspect that roof without getting your nose on the shingles.
Yeah.
So, you know, the other thing, and I'm not a salesman or anything else, but I know a lot of our guys from the school get the goat.
And right.
That seems to have been a great tool to use these days, because you don't need to have a 28-foot ladder or, you know, that kind of stuff. So, yeah, pretty much if you can climb, if you can get cougar paws and you can climb, then you should be climbing.
Right, right. Yeah, I think, and I kind of answered her a little bit in the email, but I thought this was a great question, because like you had said that was what common question, you know, do I have to climb every roof? And things are changing. You absolutely have to. I guess what I basically kind of said to her was, you have to take into consideration that the insured is owed a complete inspection, no matter how you do it. And number one, and number two, the IA firm, they don't know, when they get a big pile of claims from the carrier, they don't know which claims are steep and which ones are flat roofs and which ones are geodesic domes and which ones are whatever. So they just, you're in these three zip codes, you're getting the, you know, X number of claims in that zip code, right? So they're not gonna say, okay, well, I can't give steep ones to Jessica or, you know, or Matt or whoever. They just give them to you. If you give them back and say, I don't do steep, then it's gonna cause problems for the IA firm, because then they have to find somebody else to do it, right? So then that creates extra work for whoever's dispatching claims and your manager. So I basically said, listen, if you see one that's steep, and even, you know, I have a limit. I'm not going to get on anything higher than a 10, right? If there's an 11 or 12, my life's not worth it, right? So, but I have to find a way to scope that roof. I'm not going to give it back. And I'm definitely not going to tell a carrier or an IA firm, you know, I only do, you know, up to 612 and that's it, right? Because I think it would basically kill your odds of deployment. They would say, well, this person isn't willing to find a way to do it. We need these claims closed. Period.
Right.
Right. So,
and that's the bottom line, right? Find a way.
Yeah. Yeah.
Find a way.
There's a way. There's always a way.
There's always a way to figure out a route. And I know when I first started, because I'm scared to death of heights. when I first started, a 612 to me was like, oh my God.
Yeah.
But once I got cougar paws, then a 712 was okay.
Yeah.
And then when I had porches on the back, an 8 and a 912 was okay to walk on and get the feel of an 8 or 912, because I knew I was only going to slide down to the porch, right? I wasn't going off the roof.
Right.
So, you know, over the course of, I don't know, first 400 or 500 claims, I started getting more and more sure-footed, finding valleys.
Those kind of
things. Yeah. The other important thing, and you and I talked about this, Matt, when you were here, making sure you strap that ladder off,
mm-hmm.
right? You can get the ladder strapped off and it isn't going to go anywhere. Once you hit it, you can come down a valley and you still have a secure ladder to step onto and that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
That was always my biggest fear on steep roofs, was getting back on the ladder more so than getting off the ladder.
Right. Right. And that's, I think that going up, you've got momentum going up and it kind of takes you up the slope. You know, especially if you can get that first step off the ladder. But coming down, I mean, you want to try to, like, you're always putting the brakes on as you're coming down, because if you get momentum going down, then you're going to keep going. And when you get to the ladder, if it's not strapped off and you grab the top of the one of the uprights and it scoots over like a foot, then, I mean, your heart's just like in your chest and you have to stop, you know, cold sweat. I mean, if any sane person has a natural fear of heights. Let's just put it that way. And roofing, you know, climbing on roofs, even a flat roof, can be super dangerous. And we talked about this a lot in you know, what I'll mention later. Getting on and off your ladder, each time you do it, climbing up, getting off, climbing down, getting off, is you're taking your life in your own hands. So it's very healthy to have a fear of this. However you do it, you know, whether you have an assistant with you or you pay for ladder assist, which, you know, you can either pay for it, some carriers will pay for it. I think people have mixed results with it. But however you do it, you need to get that roof looked at properly. So it's a great question.
Coupas and those, what are those little panties that they can sell now? There's some guy that sells
the steep gear. Yeah.
Steep gear. You can slide down a roof on with pants on.
And I'll tell you what, that's a friend of mine. He was on a 12-12 and I got a call at like 1 o'clock in the afternoon. This always seems to happen. Get a call from a guy. Hey Matt, can you take me to the emergency room? No, like, hey, how you doing? Whatever. I'm like, where are you, man? Did you fall off a roof? Yeah, I fell. Can you take, I'm at the hotel, or I'm at some, laying in somebody's front yard. That, call the ambulance. Anyway, that's a whole other thing. But he was on top of the 12-12, slipped and slid down the slope, facing the slope on his hands and his knees, right? And he had no skin left on any on the palms of his hands and on his fingers. And when he hit the gutter, landed in a bush and rolled across the yard, broke some ribs, broke his foot, broke his, one of his hands. I mean, he's out. He's done. That was in like May. But that's the beginning of hail season. Those steep, I don't know if those steep gear shorts would have necessarily saved him. But if he was wearing them, I mean, you know, I've the guy that sells us, I'm drawing a blank on his name right now, but super cool guy. And he really believes in that product. I mean, he's like, and they work. I mean, if you put them on and you try to like jump down on your rear end or your hip or something and slide, you just stop, right? So if you're able to like roll over and like kind of get on one of your sides, it'll stop you from sliding because it's made out of like super grippy rubber. So worth looking into. You can find them on my website or you can go to steepgear.com. They've got them over there. They're like 40, 50 bucks, I think. Don't quote me on that.
Something like that.
Yeah. But I wanted to touch on something else that she mentioned. She says that she, dealing with insureds and contractors and everybody else in English and Spanish. And I get this question every now and then from people saying, hey, I'm fluent in Hindi. I'm fluent in Spanish. I'm fluent in French. And I'm like, that's very valuable. Like, put that at the top of your resume, because there are a lot of people in the United States who English is not their first language. And in many parts of the country, a lot of people speak mostly Spanish, right? Especially, believe it or not, in the Midwest, there are there's a large number of Hispanic communities, people who are, you know, migrant workers or whatever, and they own property, they have houses, and they have insurance. And you go to their house, and if you don't know Spanish, you're kind of hooped. You're standing there with Google, you know, Translate or whatever on your phone. But if you can speak fluent Spanish, I mean, it's a absolutely a desired skill. And even a language like French, which, I mean, here I don't know any, you know, any like French communities. Canada, there is. I know guys, I haven't done it, but they've worked in Quebec and Montreal where you have to speak French, right? And so these guys are taking along translators with them. You can speak French fluently. I mean, you could have a lot of Canadian, you know, work. So it's definitely a very valuable skill, and I would strongly suggest.
You could be the last man standing on a storm.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
I mean, one of our boss trained adjusters went out to Irma and was literally there until like January of this year, because he spoke Spanish and he was in South Florida forever.
Yeah.
And so he was the guy that just got 3 years out of the storm. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Wish I spoke Spanish.
Yeah, me too. My Spanish is terrible. I could like give directions to a cab driver and order a beer. That's about it.
Find out where the bathroom is.
Yeah, right? El Baño. okay, so let's see. Let's jump over here into the chat and see if we have anybody that's got a question for us. Pamela says she failed the tests, which I'm going to guess is probably maybe a certification or possibly a state licensing test. So any advice for people who may have failed or you may have to retake that stuff? You got any advice, Guy?
I failed.
Yeah, I did too.
I failed the first time in Arizona. They allowed us to retake it. I think I only had to wait a couple weeks or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But I just went back and studied harder.
Yeah.
You know, I always tell everybody, you only needed 70% to pass. So, you know, what do you call the guy in his medical school that graduates at the bottom of his class?
A doctor. Right. It's true. I mean, yeah. It's true.
The other thing with state license, or getting your state license, I found I probably didn't use 85% of what I learned in my state license.
Yeah.
So it really was just trying to, especially for the state license. I'm not talking about State Farm certification or any other certifications, but literally the state license is about passing the test.
Right.
Which is why there's so many training facilities in Texas. And, you know, Adjuster Pros, they're a great one for that.
Yeah.
So it's just, you know, don't get discouraged. You're not a failure. Just go back and study harder and you'll pass it.
Yep. And I would say,
I know guys have failed a couple times, so.
Yeah. It's insurance lingo and policy stuff. It's really kind of like, it's a whole other language, right? And it's a whole other world. It's like lawyers wrote it, which they did, I'm pretty sure, with those policies. I'll tell you that for me, I don't like taking those tests any more than anybody else does, but I found that, and you're not using, I mean, you, like, especially as a property adjuster, or even if you're just doing auto, you're only using a tiny fraction of all that stuff that you have to learn for that test, right? Especially for the state licenses. But some of that knowledge kind of helps to give you a little bit of a bigger picture understanding of how insurance works. So when people have questions where they say, well, why do I even have insurance anyway? You know, it helps to have that knowledge, I think, especially stuff that you get from continuing education credits when you take those courses. I think it helps to have that extra knowledge so that you're able to kind of anticipate people's questions like that and sort of guide them through the process and say, well, you know, this is covered here, and this is specifically not covered for this reason, and et cetera, and help them understand instead of just saying, well, sorry, it's not covered, and then turn and walk away, which is zero customer service score.
Right. You know, the other thing too, I know several people that this has worked well for them is flashcards.
Yeah.
Right? So taking the practice tests and creating flashcards with them. So you just take that over and over and over again. You know, here's the question. What's the answer? Here's the question. I got that wrong. And then go back and study those things. You did say something, though, just a second ago, Matt, that is critically important. Getting the state test is imperative.
Yeah.
But even once you've got that state test, you do need to understand policies. You do need to understand how insurance works so you can talk to that insured and you can have knowledge in your head of what might be covered, what might not be covered, how all that stuff works. So you do need to know it. But as far as getting your license to get past that hurdle, try flashcards.
Yeah. Yeah, that's good advice. Anything that you can do to kind of get that stuff in your brain and just seeing it multiple times. And I would say, you know, learning anything, if you sit down for a marathon, like 4-hour session, you just read through that stuff. I mean, I'm going to tell you right now, I can't do that. It's not going in my brain. I mean, I'll take it in 20 to 30, maybe 45 minute chunks and then just put it down. And you know, I think an even better way to do it, you know, using flashcards and using some sort of a learning aid like that, is to take 2 or 3 15-minute sessions a day and just sit down with that stuff and just quiz yourself and quiz yourself and quiz yourself and read a chapter, you know, quiz yourself. And you'll find that it sticks in there a lot better. And your recall, when you do sit down and take the test, the answers are there instead of like looking at those questions being like, you know, A, B, C, D, or F, none of those things, I don't even know what that is, right? Which is the worst feeling. And then you're guessing. And they say, well, you know, just your first thing, your first guess is usually correct. No, it's not. That's baloney. Not for me, anyway.
Exactly.
All right. Let's see here. How about, how many ladders do I need on a storm? Guy, I think that was your question. 8?
No. You know, I have my pickup truck, right? Mm-hmm. So I always carried a 20-footer and a 28-footer. And that got me on 100% of everything I was looking for.
Yeah.
And I think you probably get this question a lot too, Matt. Oh, do I need to go buy a truck? No, yeah. You don't need to go buy a truck. We have adjusters that literally adjust in a Toyota Camry.
Yeah.
Right? So a 14-foot extendable and maybe an 18-foot, you know, collapsible ladder, those will work. I know my 20-foot extension ladder, just because I'm a big guy, that 20-foot extension ladder got me on 95% of everything.
Yeah.
Some companies don't like you to do double pulls anymore, but it was light aluminum, so I could get on top of the first story. I could pull that ladder up. Maybe an extension ladder that is good and sturdy to get you on the first, and maybe an expandable ladder that might get you up to that 8 foot or 10 foot off of the second.
Right. Yeah. The peak of the garage.
Peak of the garage or something. Man.
Yeah. Double pulls are dangerous.
Double pulls are dangerous. And again, back in the day when I started, they told us we had to get there. So whatever it took to get to the highest ridge, that's what we had to do. And then I guess, you know, some of my old friends all died along the way, and they're like, oh, maybe you shouldn't do that anymore.
Well, and just a note about that, you know, so when we're talking about we're scoping roofs, so say you have like a, and this is like in the many places in the Midwest built in the 60s and 70s and 80s, super duper common house. It's a two-story house, right? And it's just a straight gable on the front. And then there's a garage stuck to the side of it that's got a one-story roof, right? And there's the only way to get to the two-story part is either to use a two-story ladder off the front or to climb up onto the top of the garage on the one-story, pull your ladder up and set it up and climb up onto the top. I would say this is kind of the way this sort of shakes out, right? So if you climb on that second story, then you can bill for two story, but it takes more time, and it's more dangerous, right? So it's a much higher risk. You can do most companies that I've ever worked for, if you've got a front and back slope only, right? And you have on the one story, and then the second story is also a front and back slope, and they face the same directions. So basically, you just have two basic directional slopes facing one facing north and one facing south or front and back, whatever. You can do your test squares on the one story, and if you find enough damage to total the roof on those in your test squares, then you've totaled the roof. You don't have to climb on the second story just to say that you climbed on the second story, right? So I wouldn't, you know, if you climb up onto that garage on that one story and you're like, oh my gosh, look at all this hail damage, I'm not wasting my time climbing on the second story. I might walk out to the far corner of the backyard and count the vents and everything and write them down on my sheet. And then I'm out of there. I mean, you can get the measurement, you know, if you stand on your tippy toes, you can get the measurements of the rafters, and then you can get all the rest of the measurements from the ground on that. So
do you know that you can measure a whole roof from the ground, Matt?
Really? Can you? Tell me about this.
No, if you know what Xactimate's looking for, you can measure an entire house from the ground without ever stepping on the roof.
Yeah.
So again, maybe we won't get into Xactimate, but it's really important that you know how that program works. So you can, if you need to, measure an entire roof from the ground, which is really just going around the footprint.
Yep. Yeah, that's true. I mean, as long as you know the pitch, you can,
correct,
you can get that whole thing. There's a million different ways to kind of like, because I tell you what, even if you can't access a roof like that, sometimes they're super steep and you had to crawl up through the valley to get to the top and do a little test square where you're kind of hanging onto the ridge over here. That's hard to measure that roof, and that's a big part of why it's so dangerous, is that you now have to measure all those little bumps, especially in like places like Dallas or, I mean, in Texas, so many steep roofs. A lot of places in the country, you occasionally find a steep roof, but it's these vast suburbs with, you know, 4, 5, 6, 12 pitch roofs, and that's it, right? So you may not have to get on. You might spend a whole summer and never get on a steep roof, except for maybe once or twice or half a dozen times or whatever. So you just, you never know. But you can't pick and choose. You can't say, well, I don't want to go to Dallas for a big hailstorm because there's too many steep roofs there. Just when Omaha gets hit, call me. You'll never get called.
Right.
So let's see what else we got here. Speaking of, well, you know, it's kind of like, let's hang on this like steep and high stuff for a minute. I've seen in the comments people are kind of chit-chatting about rope and harness. I do have a couple of things to say about rope and harness, and Guy, you may or may not agree. We probably agree. We agree on everything.
Of course. This is your show. So
right.
You're going to agree.
No,
I'm just kidding. That.
So I think rope and harness is a pretty critical piece of equipment to have, especially for some companies that are going to pay extra if you use your rope and harness gear to access roofs, right? So if you're not wasting time trying to coordinate with a contractor or ladder assist, if you just have the gear, some companies will pay a premium for that. I have rope and harness gear. I've had it for over 10 years. I've used it 6 times in that time, right? And which I needed to use it on those roofs. I could be argued that there's a handful of other roofs I probably should have used it on. The main problem I have with rope and harness in that sort of scenario is that you go to the training, maybe you go to pilot, take their training, or you go to there's several other places that teach it that are kind of third party places. You learn the knots, they show you all the little gadgets, the ascenders and the gree-gree and your harness and all this kind of stuff, right? Then you put that all in a big bag and you throw it in the back of your truck. And then there it sits, right, until 13 months later when you get deployed to Omaha. And then you don't use it all summer, you don't need it. And then, so then it's sitting for another 12 months, right? And then all of a sudden you got one and you're like, boy, I sure could use a rope and harness that I've had in my truck for 2.2 years now. I'm gonna break that sucker out and, you know, get the little gun that shoots the line over the thing. It's cool gadgets, right? The problem is that 2 years ago, you knew how to make a figure eight, which is the knot that is your life depends on. But do you know it now? Right? Do you remember it? You're sitting there trying to like figure out how to loop it through. Do I loop it over on itself? I can't remember, right? I rock climb, right? And I still have to like go practice the knots and refresh myself on the knots before I go out. So what I tell people is like, yeah, absolutely. Pay for the training, get it, because you can make good money with it, and you might use it a bunch in the summers, depending on where you're at, like if you're in Dallas or whatever. But in the off season, or if you find you're not using it, I keep a little piece of cord and just practice that figure eight knot. That knot will save your life. If you do it wrong, you're dead, right? So that what good did that rope and harness do for you if two years ago you paid $1,000 for the training and $1,000 for gear, and then you can't remember how to make the knot. So you're just like, well, I think that looks right. And you tie it off. And next thing you know, you're laying, you know, broken in the driveway. You know what I mean? So.
You're talking a lot about broken things.
I don't want to scare anybody off from this work, but this is one of the reasons why they pay us what they do, is because it's dangerous, number one. And number two, because we're going to drop everything. If they call us and say, hey, go to Minneapolis, we drop everything and go, right? We're on call, basically. So,
here's my 2 cents worth on rope and harness.
Sure.
I would say, if you have the opportunity to get rope and harness certified, by all means, do it. That opens up deployment possibilities that otherwise you would not have.
Yeah.
Right. I know that in my years of working for State Farm, the fact that I was rope and harness certified and they called it two-story steep certified.
Yeah.
Right? The fact that that happened meant that I was called on storms on the first wave and usually there the last man standing. Because, and not to talk bad about State Farm or anything, but a lot of State Farm staff adjusters won't climb anything above a 512.
Right.
So what would happen as an independent is we would go out to a storm and there'd be, you know, 10 staff adjusters and 10 of us independents, and 3 of us had rope and harness. Well, we got all of those two-story steep roofs. Even like you said, they weren't that steep. We didn't need our rope and harness. So having that, a lot of companies will pay you an extra $150.
Yeah.
Okay, so if I'm using my rope and harness, you're correct. In between, you need to remember how you use it. Again, I'm not trying to sell them, but I just know they work as a goat.
Yeah.
Right? So if I'm two-story steep certified and I'm getting called out on storms because of that, then I'm making an extra $150 a pop to climb them. I'm not going to say this is an absolute, but I would say with a lot of these smaller IA firms, if you go out on a storm and you say, hey, look, I'm rope and harness certified, so all of your guys who are looking for a ladder assist, have them call me. Right?
Yeah.
Now you might be getting extra claims from some of these guys because they get reassigned to you, and you're getting the extra $150.
Yeah, yeah. Plus, if you run around with a 28-foot ladder or a 32-foot ladder, same deal. Let your manager know. Say, listen, I run with a 24-footer extension ladder, and I got a 32-foot ladder. And if anybody needs, you know, help up on a roof, I'm happy to go buzz over and meet them, you know. Get some free tacos.
That's $250 I charge.
Oh yeah, yeah, $250 worth of tacos. And I'll say, you know, like you said, it's like practicing in the off season. I think that goes with any of these skills. And I would strongly say, probably more than anything, Xactimate. You gotta remain fluent in Xactimate because you can forget. I mean, I haven't been, you know, 12 years into my career, and I get a 7-month break. And then I get deployed, and I'm like cracking open Xactimate for the first time in 7 months, and I'm like, where do I start again? What's the thing? And the
right?
So practice all the stuff.
Between 2007 and 2008, Sketch came out.
Yeah, exactly.
And I was like 8 months in between storms, and I go out on my first storm in 2008, and they're like, okay, we're all using Sketch. I'm like, what's a Sketch?
Right.
I mean, the learning curve on that storm is just horrendous.
Guy, could you please add your Sketch to this and re-upload all the documents? Thanks.
Yeah.
What?
A Sketch? How's that work?
Yeah.
And you know what? I'm gonna comment on that.
Sure.
There are a lot of times where the industry changes in between. We're talking about CAT, right? So yeah. Typically November, we're done. And we're probably not gonna go back out until Easter. You know, yep. So there's a 4 or 5 month gap in that. And just like you were just saying, if you're rope and harness certified, go to climbing gym. Do whatever you need to keep that up. Your Xactimate, you know, you're better to buy a year subscription to Xactimate than you are to paying $250 while you're on storm and then not having it for that 4 months in between.
Yeah.
Because when you go back out on the next storm, you don't know, is it a different interface? Is it did it go from 27.5 to 28? What, all of those things happen when you're in between and you're not paying attention to it. I will tell you, you will lose Xactimate in 5 months. You will, that first storm will be painful.
Yeah.
To get back on the horse. And then once you're there, the rest of the year is great and you got it figured out. But if you're not up to snuff with all of these things in the beginning of the season, and you don't wait until April 1st to start breaking out your gear or start looking at your Xactimate, you need to be doing that stuff in between.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. I mean, your career depends on it. I mean, we have a high earning potential. There's no reason not to keep your skills up so that you're ready to hit the ground running. So Brad asks, he says, I got my adjuster license not that long ago, but never tried to get work. The test didn't teach me anything about the process of completing a claim. When/where do I learn that part?
AdjusterTV Plus or Veteran Adjusting School?
Yeah, there you go. Well, I will say that there are probably a million different ways to skin this cat, and this is like the eternal question, right? So how do I learn the process? I will say, Guy basically just said it, a lot of what I do on AdjusterTV is to try to teach the process, specifically time management and workflow, because we get paid by the claim, right? So we get fee schedule, commission, you call it commission, whatever. But the more claims you do during the day, and the better the quality of those claims are, and the better the quality of your customer service with those insureds, the more money you're gonna make, and the more claims they're gonna give you while you're on site, and the more deployments they're gonna give you, because they see that you have good production, which is the speed at which you turn back claims in. So, and then your claims look good, and your customers are all mostly happy, right? So if you are the person who handles 200 claims, on a, you know, a typical CAT event, and the next person behind you handles 125, and your claims all look great. On top of that, you're going to be they're going to call you. They're going to, because they want to know what you, you know. First of all, they want you to. They don't want to lose you to some other company. I'm kind of going off on a tangent here, but to kind of answer your question, the process of learning how to do claims is that's something I think that is. It's hard to get your hands on in this industry. And again, a lot of the videos that I do talk about the process. If you dig back through AdjusterTV or go to AdjusterTV.com, you can go through my archive of videos, and there's a lot of stuff that talks specifically about the process of completing a claim. Now, that being said, before you can go and work for a State Farm or Allstate, or Liberty Mutual, or any of these companies, a lot of these companies, you have to get their certification. American Family has a certification, which means that they won't give you any claims to work until you have sat through a 2-day, or with State Farm, I don't even know what it is now, but you have to take it. Yeah, so they're gonna sit you down in a class, you'll probably go to Dallas and sit in a big classroom, and then they'll show you the process. They'll say, all right, so this is how we want you to start the claim, this is how we want you to write your activity diaries, this is how you're going to do your GLRs. This is how you're going to do your invoice. This is going to be how you do the process of completing the claim, right? The carrier wants you to do it their way, so they're going to teach you how to do it their way, and then they're going to test you. You fail, then you got to retake the test, because they want you to get out in the field and not be calling up every 5 seconds asking how to use next gen, or how do I set a reserve, or how do I do this, or how do I do that, right? They want you to just do it. So when you've got your license, when you get ready to kind of get signed up, comfortable here. When you're ready to go jump on and get on IA firm rosters, go with some of the bigger companies, because they're gonna have programs set up for you to get those certifications. Like you go to Eberle or Renfro or Pilot, they're gonna say, all right, well, you can't handle any claims until you go through, you get trained to the State Farm standard at Eberle, right? So they're going to teach you how to do that, and I think they're usually free, but they're not going to teach you like the detail, like how to be an adjuster stuff that you're going to learn either through me or Guy, or just going out and doing it or riding along with somebody. They're going to teach you like the nuts and bolts of this is what a report looks like, this is how you do the tokens, this is how you do this and that and the other thing, right? So it's all like you're sitting there clicky clacking on a computer. Instead of doing like scoping and stuff like that, right? Does that make sense?
Was this guy's name Brad?
Yes.
So here's something that's super important, Brad. When you get out on your first storm, you only want to do one claim a day. And
right?
You want to tell them, do not overload me. Don't drop 40 claims on me. Don't drop 20 claims on me. How about you give me 10 claims and let me show you what I can do. And you go and you do one claim and you figure that one claim out until you can create that process that Matt's talking about. And then you'll get to 2 claims a day. And then you'll get to 3 claims a day. So often, and this is why I'm not correcting you, Matt, but I'm adding to what you said. But so often we think, oh, let's get out in the field. And you know, the guy in the hotel room next to me, he said he could do 8 a day. So I should be able to do 5. That is not true. If you're a new adjuster, the IA firms do not care if you only turn in one claim a day, as long as they know to only give you one claim a day. But if you go say, I'm ready, I'm an adjuster, and they drop 40 claims on you, and you freeze up, and you inspect 20 of them, and you haven't closed any of them, you're done.
Yeah.
So it is not a problem to say, they know it's your first storm. If they hired you, they know when they give you your first claim. So if you literally just say, hey, look, I'm brand new, go light on me, let me figure this out, and I'll be your top producer in another year.
Yeah.
That's how you build your way up the roster.
Yep.
Don't go out and become an A production guy on your first storm.
No.
Does not happen.
I think it was, I don't think I really got kind of hit my stride until like my third year.
Correct, me too.
So it's, but I didn't have any, there wasn't any YouTube or anything, you know, there weren't, I mean, it's basically, like you said, like the guy in the hotel room, you know, riding along with, you know, Bubba, and Bubba said, well, you can do this, and, you know, that's how many I do a day, and this is how I do them, and then that's how you're doing them. But, no, yeah. So I think, to be honest, one of the reasons why I started Adjuster TV kind of goes back a little bit to, actually goes way back. It goes back to Hurricane Ivan. I remember that was my fifth year as an adjuster. Hurricanes are, unless you have total losses, the claims are fairly easy. And even then, even if you have total losses, a lot of times they'll let you do a square foot thing, and then it's still pretty easy. But so many people hear about it from their, you know, guy's packing up his truck in the driveway, you know, it's, the hurricane's on the news, and the neighbor comes out and says, hey, what you doing? Oh, I'm going down to the hurricane, I'm gonna make some money. Down there. He says, oh, really? What's, like, how much can you make, you know? And then next thing you know, the guy's like, he's calling Pilot and saying, hey, I want, you know, a Pilot will say, do you have a ladder? Are you afraid of heights? Then get your butt down here. That's it. You're on the storm, right? And they will give you 70 claims or 50 claims or whatever it is, right? I mean, you could say, they know that you're new, and this is, here's a little bit of a distinction, and I've talked to IA firms about this, and they won't name names, but they admit that they do it. It's kind of a cost of doing business. They have to stay compliant with the state, right? So they have to, when they have all these, you know, 25,000 or 250,000 claims come in, the state mandates that people are contacted within X number of hours or days, that they get their first inspection within X number of days, that they get their first report within X number of days, so on and so forth. So IA firms and the carriers start throwing warm bodies at these big storms, right? Because they'll get fined, or they'll get whatever happens to them if they fail to meet those benchmarks, right? The 24-hour contact, or, you know, inspections within however many, whatever it is. So they will get people, they'll give them all these claims, so people sit there in a hotel room, you know, from 6 o'clock in the morning until 11 o'clock at night, and make all phone calls all day long, and then they'll not know what to do next. They don't know how to use Xactimate. They'll note the file, and then they'll flounder around and either get kicked off, or they'll just run away screaming, right? But they met their mark. They were compliant with whatever the state wanted. They go out and do an inspection, you know, whatever. That person isn't getting a whole lot of support because the help rooms are jam-packed full. It's five people deep around the table, and there's like six people in there to help, and good luck getting help in there, right? I saw this happen, and it didn't make sense to me. It makes sense to me now, and especially after talking to people at IA firms who say, listen, we got to do what we got to do. We have to get those claims closed one way or another. It's a cost of doing business to pay, you know, advances, and then not ever having the person close a file. It's a cost of doing business to pay day rate for somebody to sit there in a, you know, a orientation center for 3 or 4 days or a week or whatever it is until they get claims, and they send them off somewhere, and then that person never turns a claim in because they just can't hack it. I was like, well, this isn't that hard to do. There's a lot of little pieces of it, and if you know where to put them, then it's pretty easy. I mean, it's not like we're not putting satellites in orbit here, you know, splitting atoms or whatever, but so many people wouldn't be turning claims in it. And it, so I felt that that was, even though that's the, kind of the cost of doing business, I personally felt that I still want to try to give these people a chance, because this is a good job. This is a great career. It's been really good for me. I don't see any reason why anybody can't just come in and do it, you know, if they know the path to make things happen. So I wrote the Lead Adjuster Method book it's like over 10 years ago. My buddy was like, you should call it the Matthew Allen Method. And I was like, I'm not doing that. That's dumb. I'll call it the Elite Adjuster. Yeah, it's whatever. So I just kind of picked the name out of it. But it's basically that, right? It's here's the step-by-step. This is your schedule for on your first storm. You know, you can't say, in all these huge events, you can't sit there and say, I only want 10 claims. They're going to say, here's 70, right? You have to take them or not take them, right? I've got a blueprint for how to do that. It's one claim a day for the first week, right? It's just like Guy said, you go scope that, and then you go sit in the help room for as long as it takes. You grab somebody and you close that claim that day, and then you start to add on and on and on, right? So this is what happens, and this is the reason why I wrote that, and the reason why I'm doing this is because not everybody has the luxury of time to sit down and say, well, I'm going to become an adjuster. I'm going to take this time to get examine this. I'm going to get my licenses. I'm going to get certified, blah, blah, blah. It's a hurricane hits, and your neighbor is like packing his truck up and says, I want to go make a bunch of money. And then they go. And they need the help. They need people to go do it, right? So I want to.
They make just enough money on that storm to come to veteran adjusting school.
Yeah, exactly.
I swear to you, after Hurricane Irma, we had 3 students per class for the next year that storm and got those 70 claims and loved what they were doing, but crashed and burned. And went, I have no idea how did those claims close? Well, they closed because it doesn't matter what you throw up there, somebody on the back end is going to get some money in that insured's hand, because that's the most important part, right? So like you said, you got contact, you got all those things, but as soon as bad photos come in, there's somebody sitting on the inside that's going to write an estimate to get some money, even if it's wrong,
right,
into that insured's hand. So you might get 50 claims, think you did something, and you really sucked the whole time. Somebody was fixing all your stuff. So you're absolutely right, though, as far as we don't necessarily have control, but I do know if you're working with one of the big outfits, a Pilot, an Everals, a Crawford, a Worley, some of the really big outfits that have quote unquote war rooms or help centers.
Yep.
You just do one claim and you go and they sit in there. You get something, you talk to somebody and they say a tree split my house in half, and you're like, oh my God, what am I gonna do? Get in touch with a trainer.
Yeah.
Tell a trainer, I need somebody to go with me. Now they may just tell you to go out and
wing
it. Wing it, right? But most of the time they want you to be a better adjuster, so.
Yeah, they do, and they are always looking for people to kind of refresh the ranks. They're always they're looking at your numbers all the time, because valuable people who this clicks with and who it makes sense to, and they're like, I got it, and they're up there being efficient, they're turning in a great claim, they're giving the customer a great experience, no matter what's happening with the claim, they hang on to those people. It's a reoccurring theme. They hang on to the people that this clicks with, and those people, it's not like I've heard people say it can't be taught. I don't believe that, because there's so many different things that you could say it can't be taught, but I think just about anything can be. It's just steps. It's just having a mindset and understanding how to put everything together so that you can get the claim closed as quickly as possible, as accurately as possible, in a nice file that stays closed. That's what they want. Right. Let's take a look over here at the. Got actually a bunch of good questions. I feel like Mr. Craig had a question. Let me scroll up here a minute. Craig asks, are you doing anything on Xactimate Mobile, Guy, for veterans? Are you teaching that at all?
No. So we tried, but I'm an old guy, so
yeah.
I'm old school. We did make sure everybody's level 2 certified in the desktop version.
Right.
Now, Xactimate Mobile is now 28's coming out, or whatever they call it. X1 is
right.
The new one, the web-based one, and all of the rest of that. I signed up for that. I looked at it for about 2 weeks and went, forget it, my way works.
Right.
So you got to know Xactimate. So the desktop version for us and for what we train at the school is the easiest way for you to understand it. I don't know if that's one of my Craigs. I have several of them have been through the school, but once, you know, the younger adjusters, yourself, Matt, I know you're really tech savvy and that kind of stuff. It's not really hard to figure out how to use mobile.
Yeah.
3 years ago when I first looked at it, when it first came out, it totally sucked.
Right, yeah.
And like anything with Xactimate, even X1, when X1 first came out, it totally sucked. But Xactimate's so big that over the course of a year or 2 years, they work out all the bugs and it actually, you know, is a good thing. We have several of our guys who graduated from here that went to X1. There's several of them that are actually paperless now. They use their tablet and they've got PDFs that they can write on. I mean, they've put everything into that tablet where they don't even use paper, which is great. If you're, you know, if you know technology and that's good, do it. If you're an old guy like me, you do what works.
Yeah, big time. So, and I guess your point, and I get a lot of emails from people because as AdjusterTV kind of grows, they're saying that I do, like, I'm reviewing some technology here and there. So I started getting a lot more emails from folks that have, like, hey, check out my app. Check out this app. It helps you to do photos. It helps you to do this, that, and other thing. And then I get questions from people like, you know, like, Craig, you know, what about Xactimate Mobile? And I always say the same thing. And like you said, basically, and that is, there, a claim is a claim is a claim, right? The parts are, call the insured, you scope their house, and write them an estimate and hand them a check. That's it, right? So if I can be, if any individual tool, a drone, or some kind of app, or Xactimate Mobile, or whatever, if it can make me faster, like spending less time doing time-consuming tasks, and better, then I'm gonna be looking for a way to incorporate that into my workflow. What's up?
Well, so I was just gonna say, and don't learn it on a storm.
No, don't try to incorporate it on a storm.
Do not think, oh, I've been using Xactimate for 2 years and now I got this big storm, so I'm gonna go to the mobile version.
No.
If you think you wanna learn new technology or you wanna use one of these apps you're talking about, Matt, or anything like that, learn that in the off time.
Yeah.
Get good at it. Scope your house, scope your neighbor's house, scope grandma's house, whatever. But do not try to learn new technology on a storm.
No, that's gonna be a fail for sure. And again, what's that?
Did I say that? Do not do that? Did I emphasize that enough?
Let's emphasize, do not do that. Be ready to, like, have your workflow all set up and ready to go. This is how I'm gonna run on this storm. And then maybe you can take notes on the side and say, I could probably do this faster over here, you know. And again, this is like practicing Xactimate in the off season. Get X1, get Pro, or whatever it is, and mess around with mobile. Like you, I saw it 3 years ago at Elevate. Actually, it's been several years since I saw it, and it was terrible back then. But then at NACA this year, somebody pulled me aside, was like, hey man, you seen Xactimate Mobile? I was like, yeah, is it? He's like, you gotta see this. And he like starts showing me stuff on it, and I was like, holy cow. So I did an interview with, I'm gonna draw blanks on everybody's name tonight. A guy who's a project manager for Xactimate Mobile at Xactware. I interviewed him for AdjusterTV, and he set me up with a way to use Xactimate Mobile and mess with it. And I'm like, at first, when you're trying to, like, you have to pull the claim, send it to the cloud, and pull it down from the cloud, and it's kind of like confusing until you kind of like get your brain wrapped around it. And then I think that, especially for like water losses, interior, I wouldn't probably use it outside because it's, why? For on interior though, I mean, you can sketch out the room while you're standing in the middle of the room, take photos with the, you know, out of the same app, and I can drop a macro on it right there. And then when I've got my kitchen estimate written on the tablet, then I go into the dining room and I start draw another room for the dining room. And then by the time I get back to the front door, I've got a completed estimate that I can send back to Xactimate, do my activity diary, my GLR, my invoice, my this, my that, and then send it up, right? Which is kind of the fast and dirty workflow of it. But I think because I'll bring my laptop into a house and open up Sketch and do that way. So then the second I by the time I get to the last room, yeah, I'm done with the estimate. I don't want to like scope a whole huge house, especially doing daily claims when you have like $175,000 water loss or whatever it is, and then you got to go and sit in your home office or in the hotel room or wherever and just like trudge through that estimate. Do it while you're there. I mean, it does. Just say I'm gonna spend 4 hours at this house, you know, and just do the whole thing. And then when you're done, you're done, and it's done. And you're not having to do it later, having it sit on your desk and end up, you know, getting kicked down in your schedule. Well, I'll get to that one later. You know, it's death when that happens. So, Craig also asked, is it okay now to move to Xactimate X1? And I will say that you will use whatever software the carrier wants you to. So if they want you to use X1, then you use an X1. You can't, if State Farm or Allstate or whoever says, well, we're using 28, you can't say, well, I'm going to use X1. You have to use 28. That's just all there is to it. So the carriers kind of dictate how that works. And it takes them a long time to...
A couple years sometimes.
Oh, easily, yeah. I mean, X1's been up for a little while. You know, we were on 27.5 for a long time before that we ever started using 28. You just do what they tell you to do. And you should, when you get certified to work for these companies, they're gonna set up your Xactimate for you on your laptop when you go. And, you know, if you get deployed to a hurricane, you take your laptop and you hand it to a guy, and he's gonna like jump in there and do a bunch of stuff to it. Because
they are moving to X1.
Yeah.
It will happen in the next year or so where all the carriers are going to say, we use X1. Yep. So to Craig's answer, yes, ultimately, I wouldn't do it in the middle of a storm. But now would be a good time if you wanted to make that transition, and start working on it now so you have all the bugs in your mind worked out and you have your own cheat sheet. It says how I do a claim in X1. So,
yeah. Only issue with that is that you can only have one of the versions on your laptop at a time.
Correct.
Which sucks, but it is what it is. So unless you've got a second laptop,
I think it's another. You have to actually pay another.
You have to have another ExactNet ID, probably.
Yeah, another license if you got both of them on that. But although I think X1, doesn't X1, isn't that part of the desktop and it's just connected to the cloud?
I don't know. I thought the fundamental difference was going to be just in the user interface. So X1's a little bit more modern looking, but they still have, it's kind of like a covering over 28.
Gotcha.
This works basically the same. But somebody asked, Carmen asks, Xactimate desktop or Xactimate online? I'm going to tell you, use the desktop version, because if you're out in the middle of the boonies and you don't have an internet connection, you can't get in Xactimate for any reason whatsoever.
Correct.
So absolutely, you want to have...
Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, you want to use the desktop version. It's going to be faster. It's because the mobile is going to depend on your... There's a number of different reasons to use the desktop. Mobile's gonna be subject to your connection. So if you drop your connection or if it's not a good connection, it's gonna be a slow experience. Also, you can't use any keyboard shortcuts on the online version, which is, I think I might have said mobile a second ago, the online version. So if you want to control M to open up your macro list, you can't do that in the online version at all. So, and you're going to want to learn. They've took a lot of them away, but there's still some in there that are really useful, especially if you're in Sketch. There's a whole bunch of keyboard shortcuts. You can't use any of those online. And that's huge. The less you poke around with the mouse, the faster you're going to be, for sure.
I'm pretty fast with the mouse. I'm still a two-finger typer, too.
Right.
But I can still close files.
Yeah, Rebecca, Reba says install the desktop because it has online capabilities.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Let's see what else we got here. Online or pro versions. So the pro version is going to give you all three versions. You're really only going to use the desktop. I would just get the desktop. For mobile, Brett is asking, He says, for mobile, online. Oh, you're answering your question, I think. But you don't have to have a pro license to run claims. I would just get the DSL.
One of the things, one of the benefits of having pro, several of our adjusters are husband and wife teams.
Yeah.
And with the pro version, the pro online version, somebody can be out scoping the house, taking the photographs, releasing that claim, whether it's on mobile or whatever, releasing that claim back to the cloud, and somebody sitting in a whole nother state can pull that down, organize it, whatever they need to do. So it's the pro version is really great if you're working as a team with somebody else.
Yeah, we could actually, we could touch on teams a little bit. I think you and I talked about this. I think that you could be good at it. I think it can be definitely more lucrative, I guess, depending on how you do it. Some people, you'll hear about on hurricanes, they'll have one guy will get all the claims, and then he'll have like five people out and scoping for him. I'm going to recommend to not. I wouldn't do that.
No.
That's just that.
You'll get busted and get, you'll be done.
Well, yeah, plus he'll be doing claims for Pilot, for Eberle, for Renfro, for Brush Country.
Never do that.
Never do that. Just do your own claims. Never.
You take claims from a company on a storm, that's the company you're working for.
Yep.
You will get tied and twisted. Think about five companies. You work for five companies, all of them give you 50 files.
Yeah.
How are you going to turn them in? Who's first? Who's second?
Yep.
You will fail.
Yeah, it's complicated enough. Go ahead.
So I'm just going to comment on what you said about teams.
Yeah.
Right? Because I trained my son, my nephew, my godson, a bunch of people before we started the school. And you might think, wow, if there's two of us, we can make twice as much money. That is not the case.
Right.
If there's two of you, you might make an extra 35, 40%, maybe even 50%. But you are not going to double your production by having two people. What you are going to do, and one of the guys that I took with me one time forced me to start going out to eat dinner at night. And I'm too busy. I got stuff to do. And he said, it is about lifestyle.
Yeah.
So with two of us, you're going to do more production than you would by yourself. But with two of us, we can actually go have dinner. I can go to bed at 10 o'clock at night. I can get sleep, stay healthy. So the idea of having a partner or somebody else that you're working with allows you to have an easier lifestyle than getting up at 6 a.m. and being on that computer at 2 a.m. You're turning in a crap file at 2 o'clock in the morning.
That's right. Oh, yeah. You're
turning in a crap file.
Especially since you got up at 5:30 that morning, the previous morning.
Exactly. You're running on fumes. So that's where working with a partner is beneficial. Let you do a little more. It's a little bit easier. Somebody can make those contacts. They can answer those emails during the day.
Yes.
You can stay focused on your scoping, doing a good scope, writing a good estimate, etc.
So. Yeah. So, and I think this kind of, when we talk about teams, what we're really trying to do here is we're trying to find ways to multiply ourselves. Right. So it may not even necessarily be another person. It may be, for me personally, the way I like to run claims and the way that I feel that I can like be the most effective and get the most done without losing quality is to outsource my desk. Right. So emails, voicemails, making contacts, scheduling, that kind of thing, getting back into Xactimate, like, and this is where having a pro license would help, get back into Xactimate to document the file, right? So if you have somebody that's checking your voicemail and they, you might get seven voicemails, two of them you might need to call back, right? Or five of them you might need to call back. The other people might be saying, hey, yeah, I got your message, 2 o'clock on Thursday is fine, we'll see you then. I'm not calling that guy back, right? And I just spent some time listening to that voicemail and writing it down. If I have somebody that's helping me do that somewhere, like at home or at the RV or in the hotel or whatever, and then they can just note the file. This one's confirmed. This appointment's confirmed. Matt, you're good to go on this one, right? If I need to call somebody back, or if they need to be called back to have a different time, then my assistant can do that, right? Whoever I'm working with. So I, like you just said, it's the exact same thing. If two people get together and they say, all right, well, I can do six claims a day and I can do six claims a day, together we can do 12, it's not gonna happen. It's just simply not gonna happen. You might do 9 or 10, right?
Right.
But if you normally do six and you can bring somebody on that can pull your, you know, work off your plate, then, and you pay them an hourly, or you pay them like some sort of like a reasonable day rate, that's not splitting a claim 50-50, because you're still making, you know, you're not even making what you made before when you're splitting 50-50, then you're gonna save some money, and the parts that you really need to have outsourced are gonna be outsourced. And Reba's in here, and schedule it.
I was just gonna mention Reba.
So I gotta tell you this, so schedule it is Reba's baby, and it's basically an automated, piece of software. It's an automated assistant. So it'll sync up with Xactimate or Exact Analysis. All your claims will come down and it'll map them all out for you. You can build your schedule how you want. I want to start at 8 o'clock in the morning and I want to have 2 hours between each one, and ping, hit a button and it'll map them all out and it'll build your whole schedule for you. I don't want to work on Friday. I want to work 6 days a week, but not Friday, whatever. And it'll build your whole schedule. And then, you hit the contact button and it'll call all those people. Or it'll send them a text message or an email and ask them a series of questions. All the questions that you need answered, like, you know, is your mortgage company still Wells Fargo? How old's the roof? You know, is there any other place you want the adjuster to look, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then it puts that into a report, an Exact Analysis. So it'll note your file, which is required. You have to, when you contact anybody for the first time, you have to put in there, yes, I contacted the insurer. That stops the clock on your first contact, right? It stops the clock on your first contact. It's a huge deal.
Okay, I'm gonna shout out there, Reba.
Yeah.
So,
and it's cheap.
It's not cheap, but it's inexpensive and well worth it. And one of the things that I've realized with Reba, and a lot of our guys use it, is they can have 40 claims contacted in the matter of minutes. One of the things Reba told me was 85% of the people nowadays use text messaging.
Yeah.
So that software will literally send a text out to all of your contacts. All they have to do is say, I got it, and answer everything right there in the text message. You've never spoken to them. And everything's been contacted, scheduled, and everything for you. If they didn't get them, or it's a landline and they don't text, then you'll know, it'll come up orange or red or whatever color she's figured out. And you know that those are the 5 or 6 people out of 40 that I still need to make contact. It's an incredible tool to use, but again, figure it out now before the hurricane hits. Don't try to get on a hurricane and try to figure it out.
Yeah. It's important to understand how you run claims, and how you want to ideally run claims. Because if you go in there and you say, well, I can do 5 a day, and then you have schedule it set all that stuff up, and you really only do 2, then you're on the phone. You're screwed. You're calling people back, and it's not going to be a pretty scene. So,
and you know what? I'm gonna reiterate this again.
Yeah.
If you can only do 2 claims a day on a hurricane, they are going to be more than happy with you.
Oh man.
More than happy.
Yes.
Because they need to get these claims closed. Yes, you might get an email, how come you haven't inspected these guys? But if you're closing 2 good claims a day, you are doing fine.
Yep. I had I was a field support manager on Sandy. And so I got to sit in and listen to the conference call every week with the managers. 6 weeks into that storm, I had, so whoever the honcho was like, He's like, you know, we got adjusters out there that still haven't turned in any claims. And I've been seeing a lot of inspections, but no, there's a lot of adjusters who haven't turned a claim in 6 weeks into the storm. You know, your managers need to get out there and you need to get with these guys and either help them or get them out of here, right? I was baffled, blown away that it was 6 weeks and they were still letting people stay on. But somebody mentioned in the chat, you see one, close out them, right? If you go to look at four, those four need to be closed by the end of the day, whether it's midnight, right?
That's that 2 o'clock in the morning thing, right?
Yeah.
If I only inspect two, I can go to bed at 10.
Yeah.
If I inspect five, I'm going to be up until 2 o'clock in the morning, and the last two are going to suck.
Yeah.
And it works.
Yeah, you know, and just to kind of talk a little bit about the whole lifestyle thing, if you become a CAT adjuster, and it's like your living, it's like your income, like it was, has been for me, you know, up until just recently, that's all I did, right, was CAT. Every year, year after year after year, I did CAT. And when you go on CAT for 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 13, 16 months, whatever it is, you can burn out real easily, especially if you just hitting it every single day. Every day's Groundhog Day. You know, you wake up and you're climbing on roofs, you're at an estimate, you're handing a check, you go on the next one, right? You have to have some time to decompress, I think daily, you know. So I always close claims on site. I only do as many claims in a day as I can reasonably close on site. When I get done with that last one and the sun's going down over there, I'm gonna go to Applebee's, or I'm gonna go back to my hotel and get a TV dinner. I'm going to bed. And if it's 9 o'clock or 8:30, I'm out, I'm gone. I get all that stuff done during the day because I know I'm gonna be on CAT for months. So why burn out early? You know, it's not gonna help me. My production's already pretty high. My claims are all solid. I'm fully rested every night, so I'm able to be really affected every single day. I'm able to smile with insureds. I'm able to not get in fights with contractors, right? It's because I constructed my lifestyle on CAT to be, you know, I like to work a lot. It's fun, and it feels good to get to do a lot of work, but at the same time, it will wear your butt out, right? It's like going to the beach all day long. You're wore out at the end of the day, right? You don't want to like go to the beach all night again. I mean, I guess you could, you know, partying or whatever, so yeah, I mean, it's, you gotta.
You're still done.
I'm not, no, dude. All right. All right. A couple of, like, you know, with a little umbrella in there, two of those, and then I'm asleep in my lawn chair.
Exactly.
So Reba says, website is not updated yet, so you were the first to know. When you create an account on scheduleit.io, it gives you the $19.99 a month option. That's why I said it was inexpensive. She told me that today. She's like, I think we're going to do $20 a month. So there you have it. $20 a month for Scheduleit.
Yeah.
I'll drop that link in there again. Go check it out for sure, you guys.
Where's all this stuff go? You said you're dropping that link in there again.
You can't see it. Because I don't want you to get distracted.
Are you putting it in the contacts thing over on the side?
Yeah. It's on YouTube. So YouTube is live now. So all the stuff is on YouTube.
It's on YouTube.
It is.
Yeah, I'm going to have to pull this up over here and look at it.
Well, I'll tell you what. I'll send you the link.
Is that the same? Oh, there you go.
All right, so let's see what else we got here. So S Corp, so people are talking about LLCs. Yeah, I would, you know, I don't have an LLC for claims because I had been running claims for Pilot forever and it was W-2, and I don't think you can be an LLC and get a W-2.
So there's a couple things that I'll comment on LLCs, okay? You do not have to have an LLC. However, if you're working, I know a lot of our guys that are in California, they do have to have an LLC because of the Uber laws and that kind of stuff, the independent contractors. If you do have an LLC, you're going to do taxes twice, right? You got to do the LLC taxes, then you got to do your personal taxes. However, if you're going to have a partner working with you or somebody that you're going to be paying, then in that case, you may want to have an LLC. It's not mandatory. And like you said, Matt, you worked for Pilot for a long time, so you were W-2. I got a lot of our guys that say, oh, I don't want to work with Pilot because they're a W-2, or I don't want to work for Everals because they're a W-2. It's actually pretty cool because they pay half of your Social Security and they pay half of your federal tax that has to be paid right up front. So, and you can still write off your expenses, you can still write off your mileage, you can still write off your per diem, you can still write off all of your equipment and all the rest of that off your personal taxes. I do know things have changed a little bit with taxes, so I'm not absolutely, you know, super knowledgeable about that, but I never had it. I formed an LLC and then I dropped it after the second year.
Yeah. I think it's one of those, like, your mileage may vary kind of a deal. And plus, I mean, Pilot has a 401k that they match. And you can imagine on CAT, that adds up. So, you know, there's pros and cons.
Well, now I can see everybody's question.
So Reba wanted me to mention, burnout is real in the industry. Please talk to them about taking days off to write or weather days. 54% of our users do not take days off on the weekly schedule. That's interesting. Yeah, I'm a big advocate for days off for sure. And again, I mean, it kind of goes back to that lifestyle thing. I mean, when you first get deployed and when they first hand you your big pile of claims, I'm going to be honest, I'm not going to take a day off for probably the first 2 weeks. And then I'm going to take like a half day off. Usually you're taking Sunday morning off because people, a lot of people don't want you showing up at their house on Sunday morning, no matter what. But once you get to the point to where you're kind of, we call it riding the wave, where you get kind of into a storm for 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 weeks, and you start to get, you're still getting assignments coming in, but you're able to, like, you get them in on like noon on a Tuesday. And then I'm going to call them that afternoon and say, you know, because I'm going to be closed, done with everything at the end of the day on Tuesday. I'll call those people and say, hey, I'll come to you on Wednesday tomorrow. And then I'm closing those claims on Wednesday tomorrow. And then they give me 3 more claims Wednesday morning. And I call those people and do them on Thursday. So you're kind of like, you're just kind of like, as they come in, you're doing them, right? That's, you could take a whole weekend off. That's when you're like having like your family come and visit if you're like near, you know, Disneyland, or if you're, you know, near Mount Rushmore or whatever it is, you know, I'm flying home, you know, for a few days, because then I can just kind of let, you know, 10, 15, 20 claims pile up, and then I can knock those out in 3 days, right, when I get back. And I just call and make my appointments. I say, hey, I'll be there next Tuesday, and it's Thursday. People don't have a problem with that, especially 2 or 3 months into a storm, and it's a hailstorm. They don't know if they have hail damage or not. They're not in a huge rush. So you kind of get to a point, especially on CAT, where you can kind of like, you don't have to like smash everything out and like, you know, just be running gun and staying up all night. You know, you can pace yourself. It's important.
So here's my 2 cents worth.
Sure.
You schedule as many as you can inspect and close day 1, day 2, day 3, day 4 is off.
Yeah.
1, 2, 3, day 4 is off. The reason you do that is if it rains on day 3, you are not going to be able to take all of those people and go see them if you have the first 2 weeks scheduled.
Right, right.
So now I'm moving somebody back 2 weeks that I have scheduled for today.
Yep.
They are not going to be happy. However, I can take that, call that third day a rain day, move them to day 4. If I get to that fourth day and I'm all caught up, I can go back to somebody that I'm supposed to see 2 weeks from now and say, hey, can I come see you today, and move them forward. You can always move people forward. You can never move people backwards.
Right. Yeah. And so it is. And so that's one of those things.
The way it is. And so without in that pre-schedule, and I think that's kind of probably what Reba was talking about, You know, when you set up, let's just say you're using Schedule It, every fourth day I have off. I can always fill that day. I can always do whatever I want to do. Yep. But if I get a storm that has heavy damage, and I inspected and I scheduled four a day for 3 days, I'm not going to get those 12 closed. I'm not going to get them closed that night.
Yeah.
So I need that fourth day to catch up. I need that.
Yep. And that's one of those things, like, when I teach people, especially brand new people, and it's like that hurricane thing, well, you're going to do one a day, you know, I'm going to tell them exactly what you just said. It's like the calendar I've got set up for them is 3 days on and then a paper day, right? And that's like kind of your buffer day. It's kind of your, like I said, if you get rained out on the day, you've got a place to put people. If, you know, you get overwhelmed, you know, or one of your appointments runs really, really long for whatever reason, or something happens, or the person needs to reschedule, they're not getting being rescheduled two and a half weeks later. So yeah, it's built into the schedule for sure. And I'll even add, like, at the beginning of a storm, especially if it's the beginning of the season, I'm gonna go out the first day at least, I'm gonna do two or three, right? Super easy softball ones. I'm gonna turn them in that night, and then see what it gets kicked back. Matt, you forgot, you're using the wrong header. Matt, we're doing this with this thing. You know, the invoice is wrong, it's the old one, we gotta use, right? So instead of turning in, you know, scoping for 3 days and then turning in 12 or 15 claims and then having all those files kicked back, I'm just getting three kicked back, and I can fix those really easily and then send it back in. And then I'm gonna, like, kind of hit the ground, you know, ramp it up after that and do my big production. But that's an experience thing. I mean, you're gonna learn not to do that, because the first time that happens, you get 15 or 25 files. I mean, it's the Hurricane Sandy thing. People 6 weeks into the storm, they're gonna turn in 70 claims on a Tuesday, and they're gonna get every single one of those claims kicked right back to them, and they're gonna, I mean, that's just, why? But it's so why create work?
Now I'm all confused, because I got all these, I'm seeing all these chat things over on the side. Everybody, what they're saying.
Great. So now Guy's confused. So now we have
now
to.
Guy's all confused. Yes.
Everything broke down the moment Guy got confused.
Reba's answering all the questions perfectly, so I'm just going to close that.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
There you
okay.
go.
Okay. Good, Reba. Thank you.
So somebody mentioned using a Mac, and let's talk about computers for just a second, because I think this is pretty important. I used a Mac for about 5 years straight. I used the same Mac, and I had used a boot camp partition. It was a 400 gig drive. How'd that work? I had a 100 gig boot camp partition, and the rest of it was from a Mac. I'm using a Mac for right now. This is a MacBook Pro, because I need it for video editing, and I just have always, since the beginning, I've used Macs, and I use a PC because I have to. I don't use a Mac, and I don't recommend that you use a Mac for especially field claims for cat work, because working in the field is really, really tough on gear, and Macs are super expensive. For the cheapest one, you're spending a couple grand, you know, if you want to get one that's got the cojones to kind of run stuff. Out there in the field with this machine, it's getting banged around in the car, it's getting banged around in your bag, in and out of the truck in the hotel room. You know, you might have the windows down, and you get some dust in. Get a $700 PC laptop that has, you know, at least more than the recommended specs for the current Xactimate, and run with that until the thing falls apart, and then get another. They're almost disposable, right? And that's kind of the way I run claims for a long time, is use one of those PC laptops for a couple of years, and then it starts to break, and the motherboard, you know, fails, and the screen gets all different stripes and colors, and then I just go and buy another one, instead of having to, like, order a Mac and, you know, have this expensive computer that should be sitting at home, you know, in an air-conditioned room, you know, with a little pad under it to support its bottom, because it's so nice, right?
We won't even accept you to Veteran Adjusting School if you use a Mac.
Yeah. So they hate Mac users at Veteran Adjusting School.
Right, because Xactimate is a Windows-based program, Windows 10, all of the rest of those things. A PC is... And, you know, for those, the folks who do come that say, yeah, I use a Mac, we force them, they'll have to wait 6 months and prove to us that they know how to use a PC and they know how to use Windows 10 and they know how to navigate through a PC as opposed to a Mac. Not saying Macs aren't great computers, just saying that most of everything that we do is based off of a PC model.
It is, so, it is. And so you have to understand how to use the Microsoft, the operating system, because the, you know, while, you know, the computers and they do basically the same thing, essentially, you have to know how to troubleshoot your PC, right? Because your computer goes down when you're at work, then you're dead in the water, right? It's like losing your phone or something. You can't do any single, you can't do anything if your computer, or if you don't know how to, you know, get rid of the blue screen, or you don't know how to do this, that, or the other thing, like with the file hire, you can't find files, you can't figure this out, or you got to know that stuff. You got to, this is, you know, basic computer skills with Xactimate on a PC, use it every day for 10, 15 minutes, write a, you know, take two pictures of pretend water spot on the ceiling, import those photos, practice doing that, practice labeling, do all the stuff. And when Xactimate freezes up on you, then you can figure out how to troubleshoot it. You can get on, you know, eService with Xactware, and they'll help you, and you can kind of get used to the how all that stuff works, so that when you do get deployed and you are handing claims, then you're not dead in the water for a day and a half because you don't know what to do and you don't know how to fix it. It's super important, because we don't get paid by the hour.
Exactly.
Carmen asked, do you keep a separate phone for business use when contacting claims for scheduling? I do not. I just use my cell phone. Hey, they got you here all the way from Texas? Yeah, sure. It's my cell phone.
Hey, old guys, Macs don't fail. 3 years, not a single fault. That is exactly why I use a Mac. My, well, weekly, it costs nearly as much. Just saying. Okay, Brett. Agreed. You're a Mac guy. Good for you. But you can't come to veteran adjusting school.
Yeah, I mean, if you're, just listen, good. The thing is like, I have a PC laptop and a MacBook Pro. I pull my PC out when I need to do something exact to me, period. And I know how to use it. So if I was gonna like go sign up at a veteran's adjusting school, it's like saying I've got a PS4 and an Xbox, or I've got a Ford, I've got a Chevy, and I can only use the Chevy. I'm not gonna tell them I got a Ford. I'm just gonna show up in the Chevy, right? And go on. If I know how to use the computer, then it's, you know. You can use whatever you want to once you get out in the field. If you really wanna take a Mac out and put a partition on it, go for it. But I'm gonna
say. Absolutely. And you know, when I say you can't come to Veteran Adjustment, we know how to fix your PC.
Right.
If something happened to your Mac while you were here during the 6 weeks of intensive study that we have, we'd all be lost. So it's not that you're right, Brett. I am an old guy, but it's for us. It's how can we help our students, right?
Yeah.
That's a big deal for me.
All right, cool. I tell you what, I want to tell you guys about AdjusterTV Plus, especially those folks who have never heard about it. I actually created a little short video that I'm going to show you in just a second, but I wanted to let you know that I've been working on AdjusterTV Plus since last year, and Guy has been gracious enough to kind of collaborate with me on a lot of these. It's just basically, you know, adjuster scoping training videos. I was down in Sedona for a couple of weeks, and there's a lot of exclusive material in there. We spend a lot of time talking about a lot of this stuff. You know, we scope houses. Like, we had somebody follow us around with a camera, and we're like, well, here, let's talk about garage doors for 15 minutes, you know. And so we just kind of worked our way around the house, worked our way through houses. We did hail claims, we did fire claims, we did supply line fail, we did sewer backup, we did smoke claim, we did all these claims. But I'm going to show you guys this short little trailer if you haven't seen it yet, so that you can kind of get a feel for what it's all about. Hey, Mr. Insured, how's it going?
It's going great today. How are you doing?
This is actually
Guy Grand from Veteran Adjusting School. So you want to learn claims from the most experienced veteran adjusters, but you can't find anybody who will let you ride along with them? Then let me tell you about AdjusterTV Plus. Developed by AdjusterTV and its industry partners, including the high-end training center Veterans Adjusting School in Arizona, AdjusterTV Plus is a growing library of in-depth training videos created just for independent adjusters. Learn scoping and estimating from professional trainers and adjusters. Learn how to handle customer interactions with confidence. Learn the ins and outs of scoping and estimating exterior hail claims. And coming soon, detailed videos about how to handle smoke, ice dam, water claims, and auto claims. AdjusterTV Plus also features the very best of 3 years of AdjusterTV's YouTube videos, ad-free. Educational, entertaining, and inspiring. Come ride along with us on AdjusterTV Plus. Unlimited ad-free access for $29 a month, or save $99 with an annual pass for only $249.
So again, you guys can head over to AdjusterTVPlus.com right now. There's a 7-day free trial. We're adding new videos every single week, and I'm going to be honest with you, I'm a little bit scared that there might be too many training videos in there, or eventually there, I can't believe how much stuff we shot when I was down there in Arizona and how much stuff we've got kind of in the pipeline for it. So Guy, tell me, how has COVID kind of affected how your training schedule?
You know, that's a great question. We actually canceled our May class, thinking that we wanted to find out what was happening with COVID, and we should have done our May class and canceled our July class, just because Arizona's going absolutely berserk right now. But as far as the whole COVID thing goes, we are a little island, and so our students, we start again July 20th is our next class. We're full. They will come from out of town, all over the country. They'll come here. We are literally, we have our own housing. We have our own classroom. Everybody takes their temperatures in the morning. And like I said, we call it the Boss Island. So. I did want to mention something else I see Matt left for a couple minutes, though, just about the whole COVID thing. For those of you who are out there, when hurricane season hits, pay attention, because if it hits Florida, you're going to be going into a place that's a super hot spot for what's happening right now with COVID. And it's, I think it's critically important that you take care of yourselves while you're out there. So, what did Matt say? He was going to the bathroom? Okay. I ever think about a 3-day crash course? No way I could ever sneak away for 6 weeks, but would pay for a 3-day rooftop with you. Question just came in from Brett. No, Brett. It would be an awesome thing. But, you know, we're set up in such a way, and we're approved by the VA, and we're an actual licensed vocational school approved by the Board of Education. So our curriculum for the 6-week course is set. I mean, we're audited every year by both the Board of Education and already getting with COVID, day claims in Florida. Oh, cool. I tried to do a 3-day crash course during Hurricane Irma. One of our partner IA firms asked me to come out and do a 3-day crash course, and I literally couldn't even begin with anything besides how to turn on your computer. So thanks for the request, but not gonna happen.
It looks like Carmen, I don't know if you hit her question, but she was asking, her husband is a vet and he signed up for the VA vocational rehab. Did you already hit that one?
Yep, I see her right here. Yeah, so when he goes and talks to her counselor from Voc Rehab, we are on the list, so they can look us up easily. And yes, we do too. There are several Voc Rehab people that end up coming. So when Carmen, when your husband goes and talks to his counselors, just tell them that he's interested in adjusting, and then they'll look us up, and then you can go from there.
Very cool.
What is the cost of tuition? $20,000. Can't do that. I have a little ebook that comes out in the beginning. Anybody who thinks they're going to get into this business for less than $20,000 is going to end up spending $20,000 before they know it. So, you know, when I got started and I flew to Texas for a training, and then I flew to Florida for a training, and I paid for my flights and I paid for my hotels and I paid for my food, and then I went and I bought a computer and then realized it wasn't the right computer, so I had to buy another computer, got my training, all the rest of that, I spent close to $20,000 before I got my first plane. It is a very small investment in the future, in your future, of changing your life. I will say we are, and this is kind of like tooting my own horn, but I like doing it. We're 99% graduated. 96.5% of our graduates are working within the first 30 days.
Yeah. I think it's, I think it's important. I was just going to say, I think it's important for people to understand the sort of the fundamental difference between Voss and like Vail or Mile High or any other third-party company that does adjuster training. And that is you're going to learn the fundamentals. They're going to probably get you level 2 certification at these other companies. They're going to point it. There's baseboard, there's drywall, there's this, there's that, right? You're going to learn that stuff. The difference is that Veterans Adjusting School is a simulation of being deployed. So you're going to learn time management. You're going to learn the pressure of being on a cat and what to do, how to manage your time, how to deal with insurance face-to-face, like real pretend actor insurance, right? So you're going to have like the most realistic possible training that you could get short of being just thrown to the wolves on a storm, right? We can only take you so far with any training. Veterans is by far the most comprehensive. And really, it's like I talked about in the very beginning, time management, right? Workflow. This is what you're going to learn at Veterans Adjusting School in a real setting where they're holding your feet to the fire. I mean, they're not going to pull punches with you. So this is, it's critical. And
we're gonna catch you when you fall.
Exactly. So it's a padded room, right? So you've got something to land on there. Whereas on a real cat, you don't. They might just send you home. They take your claims away and send you home. And to Reba's point, you know, $20,000 out of, you know, $100,000 a year. I mean, if you go and get a bachelor's degree, and it can cost $120,000 to get a bachelor's degree, and you're gonna go get a job making $35,000 a year, right? This is a job where you can go with no training, and if you figure it out, you can make $100,000, right? I went to Vail for 3 weeks, and that didn't prepare me for the stress, the time management issues, the workflow stuff and having it click in there. I almost got kicked off my first storm because I didn't get it till I got it. And then it was like, you sink or swim. And I managed to like, you know, my nose is barely above water and I managed to swim. And that set me off on the career because I started to get it. And again, it took 2 or 3 years before it like, I really hit my stride and was like, you know, getting called all the time and the companies are trying to rely on me. But you've got to be able to have like the absolute best start that you can. That $20,000, twice that, $40,000 is a drop in the bucket compared to what you can make over the course of your career.
Especially when you can make it back in 2 or 3 months.
Exactly.
Then you get out. You know, one of the things too, and Matt, I know you know this, but for those of you who are out there, when you come to Veteran Adjusting School, you're basically, you become part of a family that lasts forever.
Yeah.
So there isn't a single one of our students that ever turned in their first claim that we didn't review it before they turned it in. So 2 years, 4 years from now, when you're out on a storm and something happens and you don't know what this product is, or you're having a question about something, we are always there, always have been, always will be. We're there for every one of our graduates for as long as they need it. We have our own private Facebook page. So during a storm, people will go on and say, hey, what about this? And they'll get 10 answers. So, you know, part of the, I say, your real money comes after you're done with coming to the school. Plus, we have 35 IA firms and carriers that are our partners with us who have agreed to waive their 2 to 4 year work experience and give our graduates a try directly out of school. Yeah. So that's a big thing. I can't promise anybody a job because it really is up to you. But what I can do is I have lots of connections and I can open doors for you and I can support you, and I know how our partners operate. So if you go to work for Pilot, for instance, I know Pilot, or Everles, I know Everles, I know their managers and that kind of stuff. So it becomes a hand holding until you feel comfortable that you don't need to call us. And it's interesting, a lot of folks ask all the time, they're like, well, how can you actually help me after I've been out for 2 years? Once you're done and you get your first batch of claims, I'll probably talk to you 3 times a week for the first 3 months. But after a while, once you get to that 20th claim, you're gonna start feeling confident. You're gonna start feeling comfortable. Then you're gonna be able to, you have created your relationship with your managers and your file reviewers. And then you'll start going to them, and then you'll call just to tell us how good you are or how much money you made on the last storm. So that's kind of how we operate.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's as you know, especially in the beginning, you got your buddies and you're on CAT, and you know, maybe you're doing sewer backup for the first time, and you're texting, you're calling all the time, like, hey man, what do you got to do? What do you do when you got this? You know, how do you put a sublimate in Xactimate? How do you do, you know? And you know, it's such and such cover. Before I call my manager, I'm reaching out to my buddies or my mentor or whoever is going to help me before I'm going to bug my manager with a question. He's going to be like, well, let me look in the policy right here now while I've got you on the phone, Matt. Don't do that. you know, and I tell you what, maybe we'll kind of look to wrap this up here a little bit, but let's hit the question that nobody's asked, but that I know everybody has, and I think it's kind of like, it's out there, and it gets talked about a lot, and that is, you know, what is really the future of independent claims, right? So what's the future of our industry? You know, the essence of what we do is that the carriers are not going to staff all the people that they need to handle huge catastrophes, right? So, or even, you know, even like doing daily claims in certain areas. So right now they rely on independent adjusters, which is us, right? And we're professional trained, licensed people who go and take care of their insureds for them. There's been a lot of talk lately, over the past 2 or 3, 4 years, about technology taking away our jobs, right? So we're gonna get automated out of the thing. You know, the insurer's gonna be on FaceTime on their phone with the desk adjuster. And I'm gonna be honest with you, that a little bit of that is actually happening. I was a staff adjuster at Liberty Mutual for a year, and they said, Matt, if you can handle it over the phone, do it, right? If you don't need to go out in the field, just take care of it. You know, if you need to FaceTime with the insured and like, you know, let's get him some money, however we can. But while they may be taking away, or we may see fewer of the little tiny claims, like one section of fence blown down kind of thing that we get a lot of, or we used to get a lot of, where the insured is like, just takes a picture of that and sends it to their desk adjuster, they still can't, insurers aren't getting on the roof and looking for hail damage, right? And the drone.
It's wind, and that fence goes down, somebody still needs to get on that roof.
So I mean, you're right, exactly. So I mean, it's, you know, but you get the point. I mean, it's little tiny, little small, little bitty claims that we may not see all those. But that doesn't mean that they still don't need trained, licensed persons. The carriers, especially having carrier experience myself, on the inside, on the other side, the number one thing, the number one metric that they work, that they emphasize at all times is customer retention, customer service, right? So the NPS scores, a net promoter score, you know, after every single claim that they do, they send out a two-question questionnaire to every insurer to survey, you know, how likely are you on a scale of 1 to 10 to recommend Safeco to your friends and family? That's all they want to know, right? QA is going to go out and they might, like, you know, double check your measurements and everything, but for them, from the insurer, they want to know if they're going to stay and if they're going to refer, right? They know, the carriers know, that the absolute best customer service experience that they could possibly have is to have a trained, licensed person come to their house with a smile on their face, who's able to answer all their questions right there. Yes, sir. Oh, yeah. You know, as a matter of fact, the answer to your question is this. Be able to scope the damage, make a coverage decision, write them a check, hand them a check, and say, you're all done. If you have any questions, call me, and I will answer the phone. And if I have to come back out, I will come back out. Not somebody in board shorts with a drone, or somebody just walking up who's, you know, was a roofing contractor the day before, or delivering pizza or whatever, not that there's anything wrong with those things, who shows up and says, I'm just here to do this to your house, right? And then you'll just have to call your desk adjuster. I don't have his number, but you just, you know, you probably have some paperwork. That's, carriers are gonna lose customers if they try to do that. And I think they found out that they did lose a few customers, because some companies really pushed that out pretty heavy over the last couple of years, and it didn't work out the way they wanted to. We're not going anywhere.
And you know, when I did, Matt, you've actually been in it a little bit longer than I have even, but when I got started, my mentor told me every 5 years the industry's gonna change.
Oh yeah.
There is some guy at a big insurance company sitting in an ivory tower somewhere with a calculator. And he's like, oh, if we do this, we're gonna save this much money. And so that will go through that entire insurance company. They will spend millions and millions of dollars for the new, just like you said, the new phone. Here, take a picture of this, right? And that's what we're gonna do. It's gonna be, all you're gonna do is take photos. Somebody else is gonna write the estimate. That's gonna work for about a year and a half until the lawsuits start coming and they start losing customers.
That already happened, yeah.
It's gonna shift backwards.
Yep.
I've seen it over and over and over again. Yeah. A new idea is a new idea. Drones, right? Everybody had to have a drone. Oh, let me go spend $1,500. I need a drone because are they still going to use adjusters? Yes, they're still going to use adjusters. Yeah. A drone cannot tell the insured how to expect their recoverable depreciation. Somebody needs to speak to them. And one other thing I wanted to mention that you just mentioned, you said inside adjuster. Well, why couldn't that be me? Couldn't I be that inside adjuster? There's a good paying job that I could be sitting in my house, right? I have several, because I know State Farm during COVID has kind of, their field adjusters aren't allowed to go in the house. They're not allowed to talk to the insured. They just climb the roof, do their work. They send that off to an inside adjuster, who a lot of our students are those inside adjusters sitting at home right now writing estimates. So
yeah.
Don't ever worry that we are not going to have work. If you suck, you're not going to work. You will always have work.
Yeah, they can't keep you busy enough. If you demonstrate that you can handle the workload and dominate the workload with a really good file, it doesn't reopen or doesn't reopen as often, and you take care of the customer and your manager's phone's not ringing, they don't want to lose people that can do that. So they're going to try to keep you as busy as possible. Doing whatever. Hey, listen, we got, you know, 16 claims in, you know, Dubuque, Iowa. You want to go get them? You know, we'll pay you at 70%. Whatever it is. They're going to try to hang on to you however they can. Right? But you have to be in it to help them and not be like, well, I'm just going to get in here and get my fee bills and just get out. You know, it's not going to work. Not that anybody's, in here is going to do that. But some people do. I do go on re-inspections and guide, you know, denying roofs from the top of the ladder, not even getting on them. And I go out and re-inspect them and they're just smashed to pieces. I'm like, how much money did that guy leave on the table? He got in, got a bunch of fee bills, you know, $350, whatever it was, and then turned and left. You know what? It doesn't make any sense to me. But, you know, he wasn't working again, so I was.
Hey, one other thing too, Matt, I want to talk about,
sure,
just a little bit about Veteran Adjusting School is, we started out as just like you, and you speak about CAT adjusting.
Yeah.
Right? And because that's what we were for so long. And when we started VOS back in 2012, it was we're training CAT adjusters. And I just want everybody to know that we train you through the whole spectrum, how to do a day claim, how to do a sewer backup, how to do a water loss, all of those parts and pieces. So when you go out there, you have the options, right? Because a lot of the folks that come to our school, you know, you can imagine somebody's been downrange for 3 tours and they had 2 babies while they were in Iraq and now they're home. They need to be with their children. They need to be with their families. So a lot of our students will leave here and say, you know what? I've decided I just want to run day claims.
Yeah.
And it might be that you have to work for 3 or 4 different IA firms in order to get enough to feed yourself. But nonetheless, I just want people to know that we're not strictly a CAT company anymore. Even though that's the way, when you go to our website, that's what we talk about.
Yeah. Well, and it's, you know, it's the flashy thing. It's the, you know, listen, people doing daily claims, it's a whole other kind of a beast. And that's another situation. Like on CAT, you're working for one company at a time. Doing daily, it may be absolutely necessary to have 4 or 5 different companies that you get 2 or 3 claims a week each from. Like that's
sure,
perfectly acceptable. And it's the way that people do it. And some people do really, really well. There's a lot of paid off $500,000 houses out there in certain places from adjusters that only do daily, right?
Yeah.
It's a good way to go. And you know, the refrigerator, the dishwasher, they don't care what the holiday is. They don't care what season it is or whatever. They're gonna break whenever. And those are the
factors blown up today.
Yeah, exactly. So it's the vast majority of the claims that you get are water claims. They're like busted appliances, supply line breaks, things like that. And you're going to get house fires. And this is totally random. Nothing to do with the weather. There's not a season for it, is what I'm basically trying to say. So daily can be a really, really good way to go. And, you know, one of the great benefits of daily, and another one is that if you're working in just one region, you're going to get to know all the contractors. You're going to get to know the desk adjusters at the carrier, you know, office that are always assigning you claims. And you can start to build relationships with those people to where, you know, when you show up on site, it's not some brand new guy, some new contractor you've never met before. It's Jeff, right? And Jeff is like, hey, you know, hey man, how's it going, buddy? How's the, you know, the this? How's the dog? How's it? You go fishing, whatever, blah, blah, blah. And you shoot the breeze for a few minutes and let's get down to business and what do you got here, right? And then he's got your email address already. He's sending you the ESX or he's, you know, man, I took care of it. I got you the Eagle before you. That happens all the time when you do daily claims. You know, those guys want to help you out. And it's a people person job. No matter who the person is, what relationship you got with them, that's it. I mean, it's like talking to a guy, you know, your mentors, talking to the managers, talking to contractors, talking to the insurer, talking to everybody. It's just a people person job. And it's not that hard. Like, I was always the guy behind the camera. Like before I was in claims, I was in TV production behind the camera. You know, I'm like running the camera or doing the teleprompter or whatever. I didn't want to be in front of the camera. Heck no. But here I am.
Yeah, I don't like being in front of the camera much either.
But I mean, it's like talking to insurers is almost like making sales calls, right? Like making a cold call. The first claims you ever get, and you're like, you got 40 claims and you got to call everybody and say, hi, my name is Matt. I'm from State Farm, blah, blah, blah. People, they're looking for help from you. And if you don't know anything or you're like uncertain or scared or whatever, that's blood in the water. I mean, people can sense that, right? So you build up confidence with it. And then after a while, it becomes really, really easy to talk to everybody.
Yeah, it's repetition, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah,
all this stuff.
You got to do it over and over and over and over again. We spend a whole day just writing scripts. And I mean, it's like being in fifth grade again, where everybody has to get up in front of the classroom. Hi, I'm Guy Grand.
And, yeah. You know,
right? And role play. It's another thing with Voss is we try to get you through those first few claims and that fear of talking to the insured while you're here.
Oh, man.
So when you get out there, it just gets easier and easier and easier. And, you know, pretty soon you get your spiel of what you say down after 20 or 30 claims. It's automatic what you say when you're making contact, what you say when you're closing the claim, all of that.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. And, you know, you start to learn people's body language, which is why this is one of the reasons why I always close claims on site, is that I can watch a person as I'm explaining the estimate to them and my scope and everything. If they're like, you know, when you're on the phone, they're like, yeah, yeah, that sounds good. Okay, fine, sure, whatever. Yeah, just send me the paperwork, whatever. But when I watch them in person, that same person saying the same thing, they're like, they have their hand over their mouth, right? And they got their arms like crossed like this, and their feet are crossed. And they're like, you know, they have some body language that says they hear what I'm saying, but they're not agreeing with it or they don't understand it. I'm going to stop and say, you know, is there anything you have a question on about this? You know, is there something that doesn't make sense that I can explain further for you, or, you know, right? It's kind of, I can prompt them a little bit instead of just being like, okay, well, you know, you're going to have to check in 7 to 10 days. Bye. You know, I hang up. And then the first thing they do is they hang up with you, and then they call their agent and say, my adjuster was just here, and he's not going to give me all the money, and I don't know how I'm supposed to get my roof done with half the money, and blah, blah, blah. He didn't hear the depreciation part, right? But if I see that person in person, and they're talking about, and I'm explaining the depreciation, and they're like, yeah, that makes sense. And they're shaking their head no, right? I'm like, okay, well, let's talk about depreciation a little bit so you understand, you know, how this is paid out, right? So you start to build up experience with that kind of thing, and the job gets easier and easier. And I hesitate to call it an easy job because it's not easy, but it's not like super hard. I mean, it's not, like I said, we're not doing brain surgery. We're crying out loud. We're just dealing with people and trying to help them, right? So, all right. Any other questions or anything from anybody?
I just want to do a shout out to all of the Voss trained adjusters I've been seeing on there.
Nice.
So, thanks, guys.
Yeah, thanks, guys, so much. And I think there'll be a little bit of replay. This will be available for a replay at some point, probably tomorrow. It's getting late. No, it's not. Anyway, we'll see you guys later. Thank you so much for watching, and have a great storm.
Thanks, everybody. Peace out.